Hello and welcome to The Hearing. I'm John.
And from Chicago's North Side, I am Scotto.
And before we get to this week's album, I don't want to get into the whole discussion again, but on Zombie Takeout, we had a long discussion about my prediction about the return of physical media. I'm going to guess that this episode's going to be the shorter of the two tonight. So it's going out first. So Zombie Takeout will be out on Monday or Tuesday. Be sure to check it, that part out at least. I think it was a good discussion.
We probably should have saved it for here, for knowing what we had. Listomania of Zombie Takeout. It's a wild review.
Yeah. Anyway, on to this week's album, which is from 1979, The Undertones by The Undertones. The Undertones are an Irish rock band formed in Derry, Northern Ireland, in 1974, who are best known for their song Teenage Kicks and for launching the career of Fergal Sharkey, who went on to have a couple of solo hits in the 80s and is now an environmental activist and possibly a member of parliament, or he's run for parliament.
Oh, wow.
Their music combines elements of punk, pop, new wave, glam, rock, and soul. The band's debut studio album was released in May of 1979 on Sire Records, produced by Roger Balcherian, and features Fergal Sharkey on lead vocals, John O'Neill on rhythm guitar and backing vocals, Damien O'Neill on lead guitar, keyboards, and backing vocals, John Bradley on bass guitar and backing vocals, and Bill Doherty on drums. Reminder, I don't edit any songs into our reviews for copyright reasons, but on our blog at johnandscotto.wordpress.com, you'll find links to The Undertones on Spotify and YouTube so you can follow along if you'd like. Track 1, Family Entertainment. I love the drum sound on this one, especially the kick. Great groove. I love Fergal Sharkey's voice.
It's, I was like, so that's where the Romantics got that riff from. But, it's the same year.
Yeah.
Isn't that wild? Because all I kept expecting is the What I Like You claps and, you know, stuff in it.
Yeah.
It's some cool melodic punk, though. You know, it's a nice intro.
Last week, as I was announcing this one, I called it proto-punk. I cut that out of the episode because I misspoke. I meant to say proto-pop punk.
Yes.
I think they were a bit ahead of the curve on that one in particular, and on an alternative. But back to Family Entertainment. Love the interplay between the guitars. Some nice dissonance in the chorus arrangement. The leads on both sides are interesting. Both of the brothers play lead guitar here and there. Even though only one of them is credited, there's leads on both sides, so I'm guessing it's both of them.
Okay.
I like the vocal arrangement towards the end. I like how the bass finally sticks out a bit at the end.
His voice is just so unusual.
Yeah.
I mean, he's obviously going for Johnny Rotten on a lot of this, but he has this almost Irish tenor kind of voice.
Yeah. Very warbly.
It's very strange to hear at first.
Track 2, Girls Don't Like It. I like how suddenly the song starts after a bit of opening dialogue, good punk groove. Sharkey's voice when he shouts gets really interesting. I think he's particularly good at that. And some great double leads at the end.
It's like a merging of the Pistols and the Ramones
here.
The production's so much cleaner than both, though. And I'm wondering if it was like that in 79. Actually, I think the version that we're doing isn't the original version of the album.
Not. But you can only do so much to clean it up when it was recorded in 79.
But actually, they re-released it like some months later, and they added Teenage Kicks and one other song.
Uh-huh.
So when I was like, I first had the original track listing and I was looking for it, I'm like, wait a minute, why is this so much longer?
But when those original recordings that were made in 79 are of a certain quality, you can't fix it that much.
Right.
You can only do so much with it. Track 3, Male Model. Groove and the chorus on this one are very Ramones. There's some nice gang vocals, nice melodic solo.
I was thinking very Buzzcocks.
Okay, they're another one they're very similar to.
And the Buzzcocks do predate them a little bit, but I'm not sure by how much work they had out by 79. And of course you get some more Pistols here. It's kind of kitschy, it's just the wanting to be that male model.
I found out about these guys from a YouTuber named Danny Sapko runs a bass guitar channel, He mentioned that they're one of his favorite bands, and I don't remember if he had mentioned Fergal Sharkey or if I had seen his name when I was looking them up, but for some reason he's stuck in my memory from the 80s from these two solo songs, partially because he's got an odd name, partially because he's got an odd voice. But I was just surprised that he was in this punk band.
I don't think I remember him from the 80s. What were his songs?
The two singles, the two ones that are best known are Good Heart and You Little Thief. When I went back to watch them on YouTube, they vaguely rang a bell. Huh, nothing special. Okay. 80s pop. But he's just got this very unusual name, very unusual voice that kind of sticks with you. Track 4, I Gotta Get A. Nice jangly opening riff. I think they were also ahead of the curve on alternative.
Well, I mean, I'd say, you know, you kind of have that CBGB scene going on for a few years before this.
But there was that jangle pop thing that kind of came about in the 80s.
That's true. That's true.
With the 60s influence that I think they were very in the forefront of.
Yeah, it's kind of our second week of a lot of 60s nostalgia.
But this is more like kind of, again, pop punk, kind of commercialized punk that brings in the 60s influence on a few songs.
Yeah, kind of picking up where the Ramones left off. The Ramones later on went to add synths, but it was kind of surprising to hear some of the
I did not expect that organ. It's an organ, not a synth. But it's got a nice insistent groove.
Of course, yeah.
I think there is a synth on a later song, though.
Yes. This song's a journey. I gotta get it. It's under 2 minutes, but it starts with kind of this Celtic sound, but then gets into that mod 60s with the organ. And, first you think, could they have done more with this? And it's like, no, this is probably the right length.
Yeah, a lot of these songs are under 2 minutes.
Yes. That's
Track 5, Teenage Kicks. Love that chromatic opening riff. Just goes down in half steps with the chords. Great guitar sounds. This sounds a lot bigger than any of the other songs on the album.
This, like I said, this was not on the original. They added this in like 5 months later. And it's kind of takes a downturn for me here because it's just too pop, you know? It feels like they kind of lost their punk. And they were fishing for the single, you know?
And it is their best known song. I like the groove. Harmonies in the chorus work really well. The claps are cheesy, but they fit.
Yeah.
Track 6, Wrong Way. Not a Sublime cover.
I forgot about that song, yeah.
Interesting change in the opening drums. The snare sounds drastically different at the beginning than it does right before the rest of the band comes in. Good groove. It almost goes kind of hardcore. Good harmonies in the chorus. Interesting use of keys in the chorus. The solo, once again, feels more 60s. It almost sounds like a 12-string.
Yeah, I like that solo at the end. A lot of these like blend together in the context of the album. So like listening to this one on its own was a lot better than within the album. I don't think they did themselves that many favors by adding the two songs and not taking two songs away like Elvis Costello did, although what we reviewed last week, Elvis Costello.
Although it's still 34 minutes. So
yes, that is true.
The album as a whole is 34 minutes and change.
Although I don't know if we pointed out though last week, those two songs they took away when Elvis Costello came to America were like my two favorite songs off the album.
Oh, wow. Track 7, Jump Boys. Opening riff kind of reminds me of I Can't Explain.
Yes.
Great drum sound. Good intense vocal. Some good harmonies on the chorus. There's this warbly guitar part in the chorus that mixes really nicely with the vocal.
Now, there was a different experience listening to this on Spotify versus listening to it in YouTube, especially this song. YouTube, it felt more like a breakdown, you know? Like there was just a bass solo kind of thing that I don't recall really hearing on Spotify. And I heard it on Spotify a lot more than I did on YouTube.
There's a bit at the end where the guitar's cut out and you do hear the bass very prominently, but it's just like the very end of the song.
Ah, this is kind of in the middle. It's like, and I think maybe it was where that warbly guitar solo was.
No,
I don't think
the
it was.
warbly part wasn't a solo. It was just a
Yeah.
note thrown into the chorus that fit in with the vocals. The solo is another one that sounded very 60s.
Yeah.
Track 8, Here Comes the Summer, great punk groove. The recording quality is a bit muddy on this one for some reason. We get some more unexpected organ, reminds me a little bit of Squeeze.
It's a lot like the Ramones doing Palisades Park, but yeah, I'm not really sure I like the organ in this one. It's just a little too on the nose. It's kind of this nostalgia inception that I think we could have just done without.
Track 9, Get Over You. That distant guitar at the beginning was an interesting choice. But it's got a good bouncy groove, great massive bass tone, good harmonies in the chorus. It seems like the reverb on everything was turned up right after the solo.
This was the other one that wasn't on the original when
Okay.
and his it's kind of into the pop again, but I think it works a lot better on this one. His vocals are just so heartfelt. It's kind of like they're the godfathers of emo.
Yeah. That's a really
Now,
good point.
I really like the line "dresses like Thatcher."
Yeah,
But yeah, they kind of lose me when they go too pop.
Track 10, Billy's Third, great heavy opening riff, good punk groove. I liked the vocal melody, good harmonies in the chorus. I like how the two guitars complement each other in the break.
Yeah, this one I'm picking for strongest. It's the vocals are more of a whine, and there's like it's a great mix with the shouting backing vocals. It's almost like it's a different person singing. Like he's changed his voice so much here. It's really an interesting delivery. And yes, they are. This song, to be confirmed, it they are the godfathers of emo. I think they really perfected the blend of pop and punk on this one and stuck the landing. It kind of feels like X took something from this too. Although I know they're probably around the same time, but I'm remembering like Los Angeles, which is a few years after it. And I love the chorus, "Oh baby, it hurts."
Track 11, Jimmy Jimmy. Another nice jangly opening riff. Again, another one that's more alternative than punk. Nice bouncy
Yeah.
groove, like the drums in the chorus. Interesting lead sound on the left in the last verse. And I like those hard panned background vocals in the last chorus.
I like this one a lot, and it grew on me after a few listens. It's I'm mostly gang vocals, but I think that's kind of what we want here, you know?
And now for something completely different, track 12, True
Yes.
Confessions. I'm
I
picking
did
this
not
one
see
for
this one
favorite.
coming.
It's just so left field.
Yeah.
The drum sound is very electronic. I kind of loved it. It's proto new wave, reminds me a bit of Devo.
Oh yes, they're definitely going for a Devo vibe. Although I feel like some of that bass line is Donna Summer's, "I
Yeah.
Feel Love."
But do either of those predate this song?
I think so.
Okay.
I just assumed it did, but I mean that has to be earlier in the game.
I think 79 might be a little bit before both of them. I'm not sure about Donna Summer, but a lot of that stuff came. This is 80s just
Jeez,
before.
that was 78.
Oh, it was. Okay, a year
Yeah.
before.
Actually, it's later than I thought it was, honestly, because I remember the story of Bowie hearing that, and I forgot, I think it was Eno and Bowie, and Eno being like, "I've heard the sound of the future." It's that.
But the guitars on this kind of almost sound like synths. There's this great backwards effect on the vocal. Like if you hear a backwards snare, you get that kind of hiss whoosh before you hear the snare hit. They just have a similar effect on the vocals where you get this kind of big sound before you get the actual vocal. And there's this nice ethereal keyboard sound in the break.
It's I think it's a synth version on both streaming services.
Okay.
I'm kind of curious what a non-synth version of this would sound like, though. It's a really interesting swerve to the album, though. You can't accuse them of just doing the same thing again and again when they throw something like this in there.
Right. Track 13, She's a Runaround. Great jangly opening riff. Great chorus. I like the chorus riff. The gang vocals are great. Interesting keyboard in the break.
It's right. It felt like YouTube, the synth was a little higher in the mix. The melody is very Sex Pistols influenced, of course.
Yeah. Track 14, I Know a Girl. Great rough guitar sound. I like the opening riff. Good insistent groove. That riff is great. I like the guitar harmonies later in the verse. Interesting timing change going into the break. Great drums, great lead guitar.
It almost could have had some brass on this, but you know, they didn't. It would have fit easily, though. The solo kind of expands really nicely, at least on the Spotify version. I didn't really pick up on it on the YouTube. And the drums are pretty much the first time I noticed them on this, really. They're really solid here, though.
Track 15, Listening In. I like that opening riff. Like how the timing picks up in the going into the verse. The lead part on the right in the verse is a nice complement to the vocal. I like the leads in the break / extended outro, because there's like in a 2-minute, 24-minute song, in a 2-minute, 24-second song, there's like a minute of vocals and then like a minute and a half instrumental break, which just rides it out. Nice to hear the bass step out a bit during that outro break. Some more unexpected keys.
I mean, this one was all right. Back towards the pop side, very early power pop, of course, but maybe that's not such a good thing. I did thought that the riff was decent though throughout.
And finally, track 16, Casbah Rock. The Casbah was a club in Derry that they played at a lot. This has a really muddy sound. It's a live performance of 50 seconds of a song about the Casbah. good groove. I like the bass line. Virgil Sharkey on this one sounds a bit like Bon Scott.
And I wonder if the Clash.
No, I think they were actually talking about the other one.
Of course, but I mean, you know,
and there's a different Casbah, there's a Casbah club in somewhere else, and I think in the UK.
Yeah.
So do you recommend it?
Oof. On the fence. There are some great moments on here, but there's also a lot of stuff I could kind of live without. So, I would check it out, because if you really like power pop, this is where it came from.
Yeah, I recommend it too. It gets a little samey, but it's good, solid, early alternative power pop, punk pop, or pop punk. And it with some very interesting vocals. Virgil Sharkey sounds like nobody else.
I would definitely go with Buzzcocks, though, over this. I thought, you know, they really threaded the needle between the two worlds that they were going for here.
That's it for the Undertones. Until next time, when we'll be reviewing Beelzebubba by the Dead Milkmen.
Oh, nice.
Always remember, never forget, wherever you go in life,
there you are.